There are two educational objectives in this lecture. The first and probably most important objective in this lab is to revisit the finite state machines that we saw in 319K. And if you recall, in 319K, we used the finite state machine to solve the problem of the traffic light. And so what we have is a general problem where we have digital inputs and digital outputs. Okay? And we have this essence of state. Okay, so before I get into it, what does state mean? If you were to equate it to the human condition, we have state. What does that mean? You have memories. Okay, so let's just decide in the room. I'm all into the happiness, right? Mm-hmm. Just get every, in your 20s, you're happy. In your 30s, you'll be happier. In your 40s, and once you get to be 60s, you'll be really happy. Okay, so what determines your happiness? Right? If we had the state of happiness, right? What would determine it? What in this would determine the human condition of happiness? Activities, okay? Sleep is good. I'll go with that. Eating is good. You know, but these are all inputs to your condition, right? But not only does it matter how much sleep I have today, what does it matter? How much sleep I had yesterday and the day before. And so we accumulate state, which is the memory, the permanent storage, if you like, of our lives. And that is true here in our finite state machine. And so, and what are the consequences of happiness? Smiling, okay? Energy, doing things, right? And so again, just like our stepper motor controller will have inputs, state, and outputs, so will our lives, okay? So, and there's one more important thing that we saw in 319K about the finite state machine was it had a pretty good control over time. Okay, so time was something it did very well in terms of looking at inputs over time or generating outputs over time. You're making the walk light flash was an example of a time. Or waiting for at least 2 seconds for the button to be pressed on the input. Those are examples of inputs and time. You might ask the question, hey John, doesn't this describe every embedded system? Think about it. It's got inputs, it's got storage, and it has outputs, and then time is important. You might say it's ubiquitous. But there are, as you might imagine, if you think about your labs this semester, there are plenty of things that we did this semester for which this finite state machine design paradigm is not appropriate. Examples. If I asked you, if I was the meanest person ever and said, of your labs, let's think about you had the Wi-Fi lab, okay, in lab 4, you had the alarm clock in lab 3, you had the audio player in lab 5, you had the A to D converter system in lab 9, and you had the DC motor controller in lab 10. Which of those is appropriate to solve with a finite state machine? Alarm clock, maybe, yeah. And I might contend none of them, okay? Because they had something that finite state machines actually don't do well, and that's real time. Okay? They don't really guaranteed bounded latency on the input devices. But the alarm clock may be one that you can see. It wouldn't be a very good alarm clock, by the way, if you tried to solve it with a finite state machine. But the exception to that rule that nothing should ever be solved with finite state machines is our trees into stepper motors. All right. So we talked about stepper motors before. This electrical model will be on the final, obviously not on the second quiz, because the second quiz doesn't include lab 10. But the answer to most questions about why did the guy get negative resistance, why is the current all weird, is for you to understand why do I need this number diode, why do I need TIP 120 and not a PN 2222. That's around our understanding of how the DC coil works in a DC motor, and it turns out one of the step, each of the stepper motor coils fits this model. Stepper motors are used, we saw last time or a couple of times ago, it's used when I'm interested in position. Okay. If I'm interested in controlling position, what this stepper motor here is, that's actually a cassette read-write head, and the stepper motor will set the track. It really bothered me when I was a young man. I don't know if you've ever seen in the museum an 8-track cassette. You've seen those big old cassettes? Okay, young Chen's old enough. He knows what it is. 8-track. It always bothered me as a young man that you didn't have to flip it over to go to the other side. Has anybody seen a cassette, a regular audio little cassette? When you get to the at the end, you have to flip it over and go the other way. Okay, but with these 8 tracks, you stuck it in and it played continuously forever. But it had 8 tracks. Okay, and it took me a while to eventually figure out how it worked. It obviously spun the motors backwards half the time, so it spun forward till it got to the end, and then it would automatically spin the other direction. So you didn't have to take it out, flip it over. But the interesting part is it had a stepper motor to align the read-write head onto the tape so that it would capture the right track. Okay? You see these in spinning disk drives. You see them in like I said, trying to get paper to go through a printer where position is the key. They're not high torque. And as we see, they are open loop. Okay. This is my demo. All the buttons do something weird. There's an Easter egg in here. You know an Easter egg in game sense? Something weird happens if you do something weird. I'll let you find the Easter egg. But what's this? That's a battery, okay? And I brought the biggest battery I had to make the emphatic point that these stepper motors are awful for power efficiency. If you don't believe me, feel it. It's hot. Just sitting there doing nothing. Okay. So push the buttons. You know, one of them makes it go clockwise. One of them makes it go counterclockwise, and the other makes it spin. Yeah, one makes it spin. One makes it go once. There are two types of stepper motors. This bipolar and unipolar. The bipolar's got 4 wires. The interface is actually almost the same. And that is the output to the motors is 5-6-10-9, 5-6-10-9. Okay? And the way it works is by reversing the polarity on the electromagnets in the device so it finds a new stable state. And I showed you that interactive JavaScript thing last week. And so this is the difference between a bipolar interface, which has 4 wires, and basically you drive the current either up or down on each, and the unipolar, which is really the same motor, it just picks out the middle of each of these windings, which we tie to plus 12 or plus 5 or whatever it is, and then in order to get the current to go the opposite direction, so in this first protocol, to get current to go up, what I'll do is I'll make this 0 and I'll make that high Z. To make this one go up, I'll make this guy 0 and that guy high Z. So if I need an interface which goes 0 or high Z, how would you do it? We've done this already. Sound familiar, Lab 10? How did you make Lab 10? If you think about what you did in your interface to the DC motor, right? What can you tell me about this pin right here? How does it behave? If the input were high, if the output of the microcontroller were high, what does this transistor do? Turns on, okay, and that voltage becomes what? this voltage right here, this VCE, what does it become? Lab 10, you're doing this now. Your lab partner built this. I'm asking this on the test. What is this voltage right here when this is 3.3 volts?
Ground.
Yeah, close to zero, okay? And what if your output is 0 volts? Oops, okay. The little cloudy things, three volts, and your output zero. If the little square, if you output a zero from the microcontroller, what does the transistor do? Right, this is 445L. Transistors are what two modes? On or off, right? So if this is 0 volts here, and that's 0 volts, how much base current do you get? None, okay? So what does the transistor do? It goes off. Okay, another name for off is high impedance. All right. So it turns out the unipolar stepper is the interface to a unipolar stepper is like four of your interfaces to your DC motor that you have right here. Okay? So we need four ports, and we're switching the wires. Whereas this guy's a little bit tricky. To get current to go up, I got to generate 0 volts here and 12 volts there. Okay, and to get this current to go up, I got to generate 12 volts here and 0 volts there. So now I need an output, which could be either 0 or plus 12. Okay. And there are chips for doing that. I'll show it to you in a second. We went over this before. There's actually there's a formula. If you count the number of teeth, right, there is a relationship between the number of teeth and the number of steps per rotation. Okay. For instance, if there are four teeth, we can see here that there's four teeth on the four possible things, we can see that this particular one will takes four steps per rotation. And so there is this relationship depending upon how you've generated the north and south magnets. This is the north magnet here. This is the south magnet. And so the second thing I want you to do is when I pass this second motor around, and that is to count, and I don't want you to actually do it because it'll take you a long time, to count the number of steps it takes for this motor to rotate once. Okay? And you're going to actually feel 50 clicks if you hand it to your lab partner and tell them to do it. They put their finger on here and rotate it one rotation, they'll feel 50 clicks. This is a 200 step per rotation motor, okay? Which is a lot better than the other one, which is like 12 steps per rotation. Much easier to count. But you can feel the steps because of the permanent magnets. Okay? Pass that one around, and this you can feel. Interesting, Facebook post to put up. How can you tell, can a blind person tell the difference between a stepper motor and a brushless DC motor? Right, you know, little dinner conversation, right? Do you remember what you felt with the brushless DC motor when you turned it? Any wiggle? I didn't brush it, I brought it. You feel the steps in a brushless DC motor, okay? You feel the steps just like you did with a stepper motor. You don't feel it so much with your DC motor. You don't feel the brushes, okay? But you do feel the permanent magnets in both the brushless DC motor and the stepper motor. But you know how a blind person tells the difference? Oops. Counts the wires. Right, if it's a four-wire thing, it's a bipolar stepper motor. If it's six wires or five wires, it's a unipolar stepper. And if it's like 12 or 14, it's a brushless DC motor. Okay, that's how a blind person tells the difference between the two. All right, so I actually went through this prior, but the point is we're going to rotate the polarity of the of the electromagnets. So this has both electromagnets in the coils and permanent magnets in the rotor. Okay, so the thing that's rotating has permanent magnets, and the thing that you're driving current through are electromagnets. And so as you drive current up and down and left and right, it will go to a stable state. And what we're going to do is flip one of those sets of coils, and that will cause it to go to another stable state that's close to. So each flip, 5, 6, 10, 9, causes it to rotate. And so again, to interface a unipolar stepper, it's just four copies of your DC motor. Like that, for instance, that looks a lot like your alarm clock buzzer, right? That looks a lot like your alarm clock buzzer. That'll drive a small. This is the actual circuit on the other launch pad. This is the circuit that's on there. Do you remember the purpose of the diode? The lab 10 question. Yeah, because of the V equals L dIdt in this coil, as this thing flips from 5, 6, 10, 9, it'll generate quite a bit of transient and cause, this would cause a fairly large voltage. But that voltage, as this thing gets up to about 6.5 volts, this diode kicks in and snubs it. It's called a snubber. All right, let's talk about finite state machines. You remember it has to go 5, 6, 10, 9, 5, 6, 10, 9. What this is a finite state machine that just spins at a constant speed. This is a constant speed finite state machine. The particular stepper motor that's connected up to the microcontroller, if the going from 5 to 6, or 6 to 10, or 10 to 9, or 9 to 5, if that causes it to rotate 18 degrees, okay, then we can look at if we run this finite state machine with time t, okay, it's then going to spin at 18 over t degrees per second. So this will be the rotational speed of this motor if we run this finite state machine every t time. It doesn't have, if I have zero inputs, how many next states do I have in my finite state machine? Remember this formula? For instance, in 319K, you had three buttons, and how many next states did you have? Eight. Okay, see the formula? If you have zero inputs, how many next states? You got one. If you have N, you have two to the N, right? So this is a fairly simple way to encode the finite state machine, is to take the number of inputs and generate in the state, this is the number of arrows that you have in your state graph. One of the fun things about design is design for change. And so if you think about a stepper motor, you can think about what could I change. I might want to change the speed. I might want to change the direction. And it turns out that I might want to change the mode. 5, 6, 10, 9 will spin the motor. But also it turns out that 5, 4, 6, 2, 10, 8, 9, 1 will also spin the motor. Not any digital thing works, but this particular sequence will also spin the motor. And when this thing spins, it spins half as much. So as you see, you know that going from 5 to 6 causes it to change 18 degrees. It turns out if you go from 5 to 4 and then go from 4 to 6, it'll do 9 degrees and 9 degrees. It's called half-stepping. And so that's another change I might want to do. And that's the essence of an abstractive design method like finite state machines, is to separate what the machine does from how it works. Okay. So this is going to be a finite state machine with one input. Okay. And so now what I'm going to do is, if the input were a zero, let me get this right. If the input were a zero, I'm going to go from 5 to 6.
if the input 5, 6, 10, 9 but if the input were a 1, I'm going to go 5, 9, 10, 6, 5. Okay?
And it turns out that it goes the other direction. Okay? And remember, the good thing about stepper motors is they allow you to control position. So in this particular software here, we can actually, if we calibrate the device and say, at this point, you are at zero, okay? This happens to be, this software was set up for a 200 steps per, a 200 steps per rotation motor, the big black one. So I can create a variable which will represent the angle on the shaft, which will be a number between 0 and 199. Let's look at this. Can you see how I would change this to be half-stepping? How might I change this to be half-stepping? Right? Half, remember, 5, 6, 10, 9 is full-stepping, but 5, 4, 6 here it is. 5, 4, 6, 2, 10, 8, 9, 1 is half step. So how would I change this finite state machine to implement half stepping?
More states.
More states. I'm just inject a state in between each of these. So I'll go from 4 states to 8 states. Okay? And then use the input to decide whether to go clockwise. This one's clockwise, and this one's, these sets are counterclockwise. Any questions here on this one?
Yeah. Does it matter to the motor how fast you go through
the states? The question Anoop asked is there a speed matter? Okay. Absolutely. Okay, so it turns out, he said, is there a speed? Anybody been to an elevator ride and the elevator goes down and hits the bottom? Or ever been this is a medical thing in your vestibular organ. You have a 3-axis accelerometer in your ear. Called the vestibular organ, and it tells you which way is up. Okay, and it turns out there are certain things that you humans don't like. Okay, and it's actually a word for it. So I'll get to it.
If we call theta the angle, and we call d theta, what would you call that? In terms of, this is our motor, right? And it's spinning. And the question was, does it matter how fast you go? That was the question. Okay, so I'm getting there. What's that?
That's the speed. This is the rotational speed. Okay, in degrees per second, right? So if this is in degrees, this is in degrees per second. What's this?
Acceleration.
But we got one more. Anybody know what this one is?
Jerk.
This is jerk. I told you it would. And stepper motors have limited jerk. Okay. So sometimes stepper motors are spec'd in terms of their maximum speed, but most of them have, if you look at it, what they're really limiting you is jerk. And so it's hard to go fast without having a third derivative. Because without a third derivative, you have no second derivative. Without a second derivative, you have no first derivative. So it turns out the thing that limits. So if you look at speed versus time, it can't do that. It will skip, okay? It'll get lost you'll ask it go from 5 to 6, and it'll go, no, I can't do that. I'm staying right where I am. Or more precisely, it'll go 5, 6, 10, 9, 5, and it go, ah, I'm already there. Right? You go 5, 6, 10, 9, and it goes, da-da. I don't have to move at all. I'm happy right where I am. Okay? And so in order for me to get it to spin, do you know what, because this causes, right? This causes a spike in the acceleration. Okay. But what changing value has minimum relative to the speed? What speed would work better? You know,
this doesn't work because this will limit. This limits the acceleration,
but there's a big jerk right there. There's an instantaneous jerk because I just did what? I just changed the acceleration, and the change in acceleration is jerk.
Okay, and so if I were to do this. And that's quadratic.
I can get it to go faster. So when I change the speed in a stepper motor, if you follow a quadratic relationship on the speed, you'll find it spins faster. And that's why this thing can wiggle back and forth, by the way. If you push down the two buttons and it wiggles, it actually wiggles with a quadratic speed. Because it actually has a reverse direction. Which would think like a lot of that would you would think that would cause a lot of jerk, but as it turns out, it uses a quadratic shape on the velocity as it's rotating back and forth in order for it to win the contest of who can wiggle the motor back and forth the fastest. That was actually the design question for which that's the answer.
Yeah, it's a great question. Anyway. All right, stepper motors, okay. And then this is a function which implements the state machine, and basically it does the output, weight, input, next, that kind of thing. But this one doesn't have the weight in it, it just does another output. And the rate in which I call clockwise will determine the speed. So in this case, I'm using a state graph to so if I want to go step it once, if it's a 5, it'll go to 6. If it's a 6, it'll go to 10. If it's a 10, it'll go to 9. And if it's a 9, it'll go to 5. That's the essence of what's going on here. And this is going to keep track of my angle. Why is this here?
Give me two good reasons for this line code. It has two beautiful factors.
It's specific addressing?
It does use specific addressing, okay? So if you drill down on the specific addressing, what beautiful thing does specific addressing mean? That just means when you go to ST Microsystems, it won't work anymore. Or if you try to use a Freescale processor, it won't work anymore. Because the Freescale and the SD Microsystems don't do, that's a TI thing, by the way. So one might argue specific addressing is a bad thing, because now this code won't run on another processor, by the way. Unless you love your TI, say, I wear my TI shirt. Then it works on other TI processors. But there is something good about specific addressing. What's up? Yeah, I'm writing to the whole thing, but I'm only modifying, right? The bottom the bottom parts of this are 3C of this address, which means it's going to affect, and I don't know if anybody has memorized what that is. 4007. Somebody know what that one is? You have your port addresses memorized?
Oh boy. 4 is A. 5 is B, 6 is C, 7, D. That's port D.
I know, by the way, you don't have to memorize that, but that happens to be port D. Bits, right?
Right, these bits are 0, 1, 2, and 3. So this is going to PD3 through PD0.
Okay, and it does it in a friendly manner. That was the first good thing about this. But it has another good thing, by the way. What do you do with software that's old? You know, 99% of the time you're writing software, what are you doing?
Debugging.
Well, okay. Yeah. The other 99, he said the answer was debugging. Yeah, go. Yeah, good. The other 99%, so you might ask the question, does this software facilitate debugging, by the way? Maybe not, because it's, you know, it's hard to tell where it is. I don't know. I wouldn't know where to hook up the port, because I had to look up the thing. So, but the other 99%, you're doing maintenance or changing. Okay, so I pose this question. Is this easy to change? Yeah. I can easily go to another port by changing this, and the software really is the same. All right. Is it easy to go from a 200-step stepper motor to a 50-step stepper motor? Not really, because you don't know where all in the code. There's a bunch of those, right? There's one here, and there's another one over there, right? And so, you know, it's you got to get them all, so be careful. So the rule is don't use a defined statement unless changing it makes sense, by the way. So don't abstract something that can't be abstracted. So abstract it, that's good. And this is what it would look like if we were doing half steps. And this is what, you know, so a half step would require 400 here because now there are 400 steps per rotation. So again, you wanna think about change. Okay, and that's one of the three things you do in your quality of your software, okay? There are three things I want you to think about. Is it easy to understand? Okay, is it easy to understand? And if it's easy to understand, like I would contend that this is fairly easy to understand. Just, there's no comments there, right? You can see that if the input were a 0, it goes 5, 4, 6, 2, 10. If the input were a 1, it goes in the other direction, okay? Is it easy to understand? Is it easy to debug? Okay. How might I have changed this to make it easier to debug? I might put a heartbeat in there, right? I might put a dump. Like, what was the last time I wrote to it? Or more interesting, when did I write it last? That might be an interesting thing. How long, what was the time difference between writes to it? Or how many times did I write to it? And so, is it easy to debug? And is it easy to change? Okay. Because change is how we're going to make our money. We're going to write code that's easy to change, and then people will buy it. Okay? So I would contend that these are all things that finite state machine solutions allow you to do, and that is to abstract what it does from how it works. And there's the structure, left and right. Again, you can see that it's fairly easy to understand. This is an interesting quiz here. I have two sensors and one motor. The motor can, one robot, it can go straight, it can turn left, or it can turn right. And this is my contention about finite state machines, okay? With no other information other than that, okay? There we are. You know it's a robot, okay? You know it has three options. It can go straight, it can go left, it can go right. And it has two sensors that either are both on, one is on, or the other one is on. And if one is on, it'll turn left. If the other one's on, it'll turn right. What is it? You venture into the code world and you see this in front of you. Does it, okay. Right, so it's either gonna go straight, it's going to turn left,
or it's going to turn right. Depending, right? Depending on whether or not it sees its sensor. Okay?
Can you see what it's doing?
Here's my robot. Okay. You guys are gonna need more graphical help here. So
it's a line follower. Okay? It's a line follower. The point of a finite, it is a line follower, that's the right answer.
The point of a line follower is if I showed you, if you said, give me some C code, write me C code that follows a line, and you had some if-thens in it, and you weren't allowed to make any comments or any cool thoughts, I think finite state machines are inherently descriptive in what they do. Okay? If you start with what the inputs mean and you understand what the outputs do, I think looking at this finite state machine is inherently descriptive to the non-skilled, to the non-artistic. Okay? And that is the benefit here of finite state machines. Okay? Now, the ones we do in the book, the ones you did in 319K, are only 20 states or whatever. But if you think about the engine, port B equals the pointer to the output, the input equals, you know, port A, and then we do the weight port to time, and we do next equals next to next, depending on the input. Right, this is the finite state machine engine that we did in 319K for 20 states. But what does this engine look like if I have 100 states, 1,000 states, 10,000 states? What does it look like? What does this engine look like when I increase the number of states? Not the number of inputs, okay? But the number of states. It's exactly the same. That's why this is powerful. Because it separates, it puts all the intellect into the state graph. So clearly a 10-state finite state machine is not as complicated as a 100-state state machine. Yeah. But it does allow you to put into graphical form the relationship between the inputs and outputs, and make it very easy to debug. Because if you get these four steps right, and they're gonna be right forever. And if I add more outputs or more inputs, yes, it's gonna change. But it won't change a lot, by the way. Right, so again, if to go from, you know, to go from two inputs to three inputs to four inputs, that's all that's going to change. So in summary, finite state machines is nice to have in your toolbox. I know we don't have a lab on it. I really wanted you guys to spin the motor with a DC motor just to be fun and interesting. But to remember, there are even though we had no labs on finite state machines, don't forget that in your toolbox going forward. That lab we did in 319K is very important. Questions?